Hey guys, it's Nick and Kristen. We're here behind the mic with 101.9 The Wolf and Waterloo Revival.
Woo! What's going on, guys?
Cody, George, thank you guys so much for coming by.
Thanks so much for letting us come hang.
Love the In-N-Out shirt.
Hey, you know, palm trees, lightning. I thought it was a cool California shirt. They've been giving me crap about it all day.
That's kind of why I had to say
If it looks like good In-N-Out, you know it's good. That's what I've got to say.
Right.
Yeah, we actually just had In-N-Out today. So, I mean, we're like, oh, yeah.
And y'all didn't
representing.
Y'all didn't invite us?
Oh, no.
I feel really left out right now.
Well, I mean, relatively new, obviously.
Yeah.
For the people watching, tell us about Waterloo Revival.
So Cody and I have known each other since like sixth grade, and he actually taught me how to play guitar. It took him about 2 years to teach me how to play three chords or something.
I take no credit for his actual guitar playing skills.
I was just saying nice stuff about you, and then you come
in. He just got
that.
You to the first part, and now it's all your fault.
That or his fashion sense.
But I'm going to excuse myself.
I think you're telling a story.
But we started writing songs together in about ninth grade, and so we were high school band. We kept writing songs in college. He left to go to North Texas in Dallas. I stayed in Austin, where we grew up, went to the University of Texas. But like spring break, Christmas break, we would keep writing songs because it's what we love to do.
Yeah.
And so after we graduated, just kind of more than anything is like an outlet for our songwriting and playing live music, we started Waterloo Revival, which we are today. And we never really started it with the intention of it becoming anything other than that. And we started to get a little bit of a following in Austin, and kind of just through dumb luck, our demo got passed through the right hands and onto the desk of Scott Borchetta, who's now the president of Big Machine Records. And 2 weeks within hearing the demo, he offered us a record deal when we moved to Nashville.
Wow. Yeah. So that's crazy.
That was October of last year, and now we're touring the country behind our first single. So it's been pretty cool.
That is insane.
What did you do to celebrate the record deal?
We popped a bottle of champagne.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
it was actually, I guess, a wedding gift that we'd given you, but we'd been saving it for like the right...
When we signed
musical,
the first
it was from like our
which
our
is funny. Like we were like we were in our slacks and button downs from our desk jobs, and like we did not look like rock stars at all. And we're signing a record deal with Big Machine Records, and we're like, we're probably gonna have to get a new wardrobe.
Yeah, probably.
Speaking of which, you guys actually did something really boring before that, right?
Yeah,
very boring.
Now, explain what that was.
I was doing mortgage loan underwriting, which is really exciting.
Sounds exciting, yeah.
And I was working in finance and commercial real estate. So.
Yeah, big career.
Yes, the rock stars.
Numbers.
We're pretty glad with the way it ended up.
Yeah, it turned out well.
Now, one of the things that I love about you guys is that you were kind of fan-funded in the beginning.
Definitely.
With like a group of 200 loyal fans. Tell us about that.
It was one of those things that... you know, we started playing music in Austin just as something that was for us. And then our first show, we had about 200 people show up. And we're like, okay, maybe more people than just us want to hear this. And so we synced up with a guy named Matt Noveski, who is the bassist for a multi-platinum rock band, Blue October. And he was the one that kind of took us into the studio for the first time to make a record. And that's a really expensive endeavor. So we were like, well, we'll start a Kickstarter, see if anybody else wants to hear this music.
Cool.
Never really expecting it to get funded. And it funded immediately.
Yeah.
And so that was what kind of kicks us off and made us think that, okay, this is something we should take a little bit more seriously.
Yeah, that would be a good sign.
Yeah,
definitely.
Well, so we have to ask, we always ask a bunch of fun questions for you guys.
Yeah, please.
I know that, which one's a Corvette fan? Corvette fan, okay.
Yes, yes.
All right, so what was your very first car? I'm sure it wasn't a Corvette.
It was not a Corvette. It was not, I wish.
The way your luck's going, it might
be. I know, seriously, it might be. 2 weeks.
No, it was a 1993 Ford Bronco. It was forest green with a tan roof.
The Eddie Bauer, yeah.
Oh, was it Eddie
it
Bauer?
It was the coolest car there was.
That's pretty stylish.
A total chick magnet. Unfortunately, I was not a chick magnet, so it kind of evened out.
Yeah, and I'm assuming you didn't get it in 1993 when it was brand
no,
new.
No. I got it in 2004, something like that.
Okay, so,
All right. It so had it a little roadway. Yeah.
I had a Mazda Protege.
Really?
Yeah. Right.
Which I know totaled like in a couple of years.
On the racing scene, that's hot, right? On the or no?
Maybe.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah,
had, like,
you pulled
the
like Tokyo Drift kind of stuff with that. Yeah.
I feel like that's important.
Had like the smallest engine you could possibly get. So.
Maybe that's why they liked it. So what would be your spirit animal if you had to choose one?
You start.
Koala bear.
Okay, why?
He's like such an Australian guy. Last time, I've gotten that question a couple of times, and his first answer, which is why I told him to go first, was a kangaroo. And when the follow-up question was why, he said, because they're cool. And I was like...
they are kind of cool.
So now he's chit. I would be curious to hear why the koala bear
is. Yeah, that would be exciting.
Because I'm cute and cuddly.
But vicious. They're vicious.
Yeah, that's very awesome. Vicious.
Careful, they're vicious on the inside.
That's awesome.
Well, since you guys grew up together, what was the sixth grade embarrassing moment that you want to share about each other?
Oh, yeah. You guys have
Well,
to have
fun fact about Cody, and I'm hoping that...
super fun
yeah,
fact.
I'm hoping that we get some cameras into his parents' house so we can find these pictures. But Cody used to wear like the most stereotypical, enormous Coke bottle glasses in sixth grade. Like, they were amazing, and he was a saxophone player. So,
That's actually cool, well, right?
That's cool, though.
That balances out because no matter how geeky you look, if you have a saxophone, the ladies love you.
Yeah, I just remember, George, you always had the puka shell necklace and all that.
Still
and
cool, right?
He gets super red really easily, especially like during the summertime. With sun, he gets sunburned really easily.
Thank you, Cody.
And he'd take it off during the summer, and he'd have this big, like, tan line from the puka shells. And
so, like, no matter what, I had a puka shell tan line.
I remember the puka shell age.
I want to see that in, like, a school picture. Like,
it's brutal. I also had, like, spiked my hair straight
up. I was just saying, there's got to be like, first of all, tell us about the single, the one that's kind of going forth now.
Yeah, it's called Hit the Road, and it's a song that really, like, changed everything for us. We were playing as Waterloo Revival in Austin, and we were recording a record at the time. And we'd had about 7 songs done for it, and we felt like there was just something missing. So the guy that was producing the record said, why don't you guys fly out to Nashville and meet up with my buddy who's a writer out there? And so we did, and that was our first trip to Nashville and our first time really writing with anybody besides each other.
Yeah.
And within an hour and a half, we had written this song, Hit the Road, and I think we walked out of it. And, like, that feels like something pretty special.
It was kind
of
like the sound we were looking for because we didn't quite capture it on the songs that we were recording on. I mean, independently, they were great, but as a whole, there was some element that was missing to it, and we left and we're like, this is finally what
we're
looking for.
Yeah.
So we immediately went and we tracked it. We finished, we had like the finally fully mixed version of it within 5 days, I want to say, of writing it.
And so that's a song that ended up getting passed down the line. It was the reason that we got our record deal, and now is our debut single for Team Country.
Congratulations, guys.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming to Sacramento. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having us, guys.
Behind the mic on 101.9 The Wind. I can't write, cause there ain't a word for what it feels like. Shooting that smile over here, yeah, my way, girl. You got me thinking about the high.